My name's Junius Rodriguez, and I'm Associate Professor of History here at Eureka College. I'm in my 19th year here at Eureka. And it's a pleasure to be involved in today's conference. It's a great day for Eureka College and a great day for historical studies of the Reagan era and Mr. Reagan's connection to the Midwest. Technically, we're starting the 1 o'clock session right now, even though we're about 20 minutes behind schedule. But we'll make things work out in the end. It's guaranteed. Now, any of you associated with education, higher education, are well aware that the 1 o'clock hour is affectionately known sometimes as nap time, coming after lunch. That won't happen today. We're going to challenge basically nature and biology because we have two outstanding presentations. And I'll just do a brief comment or so and then introduce our first speaker and we'll get on with the two presentations, and there will be question and answer opportunities that follow the second presentation. When we think about history, in essence, history is two things. History is things as they happen, as they transpire, those things that we are a part of. For example, being here today, being involved in this event, is in many respects historic. It's part of history. But there's another type of history as well, which is one that is more reflective and one that takes the passage of time before it can truly be processed. Keep in mind that we are now three decades removed from Mr. Reagan's inauguration as President of the United States. And with the passage of a generation, there has been opportunity for reflection to occur and for historical accounts to begin to come into being that look upon the primary source record of the Reagan era and of Mr. Reagan's life. And in today's evening, afternoon sessions, we're going to see part of that process begin as a new generation of scholars begins to look at the Reagan legacy. When historians use primary sources, they're using written records, they're using artifacts, they're using formulations of memory. And from these primary sources, we try to fashion together a complete understanding, or as complete an understanding as we can, of the past. But the truth of the matter is that the record is never complete. And in particular, when we look at Mr. Reagan's writings about his youth, there are voids that appear. The story is not completely told. And in many respects, historians would say that sometimes the silences themselves speak. But historians would also say that it's within those silences that we find the opportunities to interpret and to try to weave together a more tidy narrative. We also find history processed in the public sphere and within popular culture. And oftentimes there, what we'll see is the marriage of myth and legend that begins to fill in some of these particular empty spots, some of these voids that do appear. And I think both of the presenters this afternoon are going to be looking at those areas where the mythology, the legend, the media image, all of these things really sort of come together to help to create or formulate varied understandings of Mr. Reagan's youth, varied understandings of his career as a politician, and eventually as a governor and as president. With that, it's with great pleasure that I introduce today's first speaker, who I would assume has traveled the farthest to be with us today. Roger Johnson has recently received his PhD in American Studies in the UK at the University of Sussex. He's done quite a bit of work on the remembered past, the way that memory really sort of is part of that formulation of how we do history, how we think about history. He has several publications that deal in particular with the ending of the Cold War, Mr. Reagan's association with that. And he's going to be speaking this afternoon about myth, history, and Reagan's youth and presidential biography. It's with great pleasure that I introduce Professor Johnson.
Thank you. Yeah, I'd like to say I've been studying Reagan for a number of years, so I consider it a real privilege to be here to see Eureka and to observe today, and hopefully I can contribute something useful with my paper, which is about how various authors have... Oh, sure. how various authors have represented Reagan's childhood and understood it within a certain mythic context. Ronald Reagan's childhood is a story both within and about American mythology. This is a term which I define broadly as the communication of shared symbols and stories about the past, offering meaning and argument about collective identity and purpose. Reagan's biographers understand and represent his childhood functionally as a symbolic story about his presidency. It is written to define his later leadership. Furthermore, the presidency itself is a symbolic office, representative of American democracy. Its holders, meanwhile, symbolize the continuity and the development of American history, as well as the character of their eras. Reagan's childhood is about the age he would later live through and define. Such might be said about any presidential biographical subject. Specifically, however, Reagan is intimately connected to the themes and representation of American myth. Any significant president is a figure within American mythology, but Reagan is a symbol of American mythology. This rests on his presidency, his rhetorical leadership, the achievements and failures that are attributed to him, but also on his persistent identity as a Hollywood actor. This idea is consistent within all discussion of Reagan, critical and supportive, based on his twin images as the great communicator of the shining city and savior of American optimism and faith, and as the actor president who dazzled a forgetful America with Hollywood performance and fable. It is these images which retrospectively define Reagan's youth. Presidential biography has its roots in a 19th century tradition where the lives of the great were written and read for improvement as instruction or caution. The historian Scott Casper studied this early American culture of biography, showing it to be, quote, part of a multifaceted effort to create a national identity and culture. This moral tradition faltered and diversified in the 20th century under the varied influences of professional history, psychology, and celebrity culture. But in presidential biography, the function of defining national identity around the subject persists, even if the author's intent is not always as civic-minded as that of Parson Weems in his Lives of George Washington. In campaigns, biography is employed to advance a candidate's qualification for office, frequently relying on iconic conventions about presidential origins. In the historiography and remembrance of a president, his representation of America carries back into his earlier life, and his biography becomes national history. Prominent amongst the biographers who have sought to define and defend their craft as a distinct literary form, Leon Adel claimed that it was the biographer's duty to seek out and unlock the inner or covert myth of their subject, quote, a part of the hidden dreams of our biographical subjects lodged in the unconscious. When the subject symbolizes the nation, his inner myths are the reflection and catalyst of America's own. Reagan's childhood has been retold several times in several forms since long before his presidency. I will refer specifically, however, to just four biographies: Gary Wills' Reagan's America, Edmund Morris's Dutch, Paul Kengel's God and Ronald Reagan, and Michael Rogan's biographical essay, Ronald Reagan, the Movie. These texts have not only been successful and influential in the historiography of Reagan, but they also collectively offer broad and ambitious interpretation. Wills and Rogan both wrote in 1987, responding to Reagan's presidency as a phenomenon of American culture and understanding it through the story of Reagan's pre-political life. Morris was Reagan's official biographer, a position that resulted in the publication of the long-awaited and highly controversial Dutch in 1999. The controversy responded less to the substance of his interpretation than its method, a blend of fiction, memoir, and biography. Morris, who described himself as, for better or worse, simply a narrative biographer rather than a historian, turned to literary innovation to express the themes of Reagan's life and presidency. Paul Kengel's 2004 biography stands out amongst this selection for its unabashed support of Reagan, for its confidence in his greatness and goodness. His biography was about Reagan's Christian faith, but as an offshoot of a larger project, later published in 2007 as The Crusader, Ronald Reagan and the Fall of Communism, it was also involved in making a case for Reagan's personal role in achieving a Cold War victory. Though disparate in their positions and purposes, each author approaches Reagan's life as a story about America and projected it onto their representation of his childhood. For Gary Wills, Ronald Reagan was the, quote, great American synecdoche, a durable daylight bundle of meanings whose experiences, imagination and ideas reflected those of the nation and provided the nation with aspiration and iconic example, or myth. For Wills, Reagan allowed America to elide its contradictions and divisions through nostalgic reimagination of the past and visionary imagination of the future. His narrative is structured around a critical analysis of Reagan's own account of his childhood in Where's the Rest of Me?, his first autobiography, published in 1965. Wills tells us that this was, quote, a political campaign waiting to happen and a piece of rhetoric to be analysed as such, something designed to make an effect on the audience. The author takes his cue from Reagan's description of his childhood as, quote, one of those rare Huck Finn, Tom Sawyer idylls. In the first instance, this is an indication of a sanitized historical memory. Wills reminds the reader of the nature of Mark Twain's world, represented in his, quote, chronicles of superstition, racism, and crime, by reference to a lynching in Tampico, Illinois, just 5 years before Reagan was born there, and the local paper's unconcerned reporting. New century or old, Wills wrote, the country was still living through Huck Finn, Tom Sawyer dreams, which were never as idyllic as Reagan remembers. Wills does not simply accuse Reagan of nostalgia, but aligns him with the blindness and self-delusion of turn-of-the-century America. The point that Reagan misremembered and romanticised his own and American's past is immediate and consistent throughout the book, but Wills takes his commentary further. There is, he says, a special poignancy in his superficial gesture towards Huck Finn, since there is much of Twain's Mississippi in Reagan's background. What follows in these opening pages is a portrait of 19th century Midwestern life, as experienced by Reagan's father and grandfather and as understood by Mark Twain. Wills turns to Twain's life on the Mississippi and its twin expressions of nostalgia for the simplicity of the past and yearning optimism in the rapid technological expansion of river life and its promise of civilizational progress. The comparison with Reagan is implicit, but ever clearer with Wills' representation of his subject as a man similarly affected by both dreamy fondness for the past and confidence in the future. The difference is also implicit. Twain, we are reminded, was by the end of his life disillusioned with American progress and power and fearful of the 20th century. Reagan, born a year after Twain's death and going strong in 1986, suffers few doubts about America's nature or destiny. This introductory association of Reagan with Twain, however, locates Reagan within an American iconography, one of fable and national identity. Wills portrays Reagan as born to the stories and symbols of America and makes him, like Twain, the storyteller of his age. This theme persists through the narrative in Wills' continual reference to films, often Reagan's own, and their illustration and invocation of American myth. The book itself opens with a scene from King's Row, where Reagan's character celebrates the turn of the century, symbolically ushering in his own age. Wills identified Hollywood cinema and its stories as influences on and expressions of the mythology of Reagan's America. Michael Rogan went further, arguing that Reagan's inner myth itself was a cinematic narrative and that movies had consumed his memory. For Rogan, Reagan's life was defined by, quote, an uncanny slippage between life and film, his confusion of movies and reality extending to his own identity. Like Wills, Rogan turned to Reagan's own account of his childhood, finding significance in the incident where the 9-year-old future president encountered his father, passed out and drunk in the snow at the door of their house. Wills was sceptical of efforts to psychoanalyze the president and his politics through what he saw as a deliberate piece of rhetoric. He was particularly critical of how presidential historian Robert Dalek interpreted the event and its consequences in the premature 1983 account of Reagan's presidency, The Politics of Symbolism. Dalek's elaborate idea that the story showed the roots of Reagan's politics, a fear of dependence and a mistrust of authority, is central to Rogan's own argument, but Rogan expanded it by saying that the trauma of the event led Reagan to seek reinvention in his Hollywood roles. Newt Rockne, All-American, for example, quote, inverted Reagan's familial past, replacing an unreliable dependent father with an idealized, strong one. King's Row, on the other hand, gave Reagan catharsis by providing an exaggerated family horror story from which he could escape through a symbolic act of amputation. The two films that made Reagan a star, argued Rogan, supplied him with an idealized authority he could sacrifice and a sadistic one he could be punished by and then overcome. Freed from the gothic small town, Reagan would re-inhabit as fantasy life for millions, an ideal version of the American past. The essay, in its final form, was published in a collection titled Ronald Reagan the Movie and Other Episodes in Political Demonology. Demonology, in the author's words, was the attribution of a, quote, magical pervasive power to a conspiratorial centre of evil. It is the refuge of the counter-subversive who, quote, needs monsters to give shape to his anxieties and to permit him to indulge his forbidden desires. The cinema is a central theme of Rogan's study of American political history as the medium through which Americans, from D.W. Griffith's Birth of a Nation to the Cold War, played out their fears and reimagined themselves. Reagan's involvement in the production of paranoid and repressive Hollywood narratives, combined with his anti-communist conservative political leadership, makes him a vital figure in Rogan's tradition of counter-subversive demonology. Indeed, for Rogan, Reagan's political activity only makes sense in relation to his Hollywood identity. Reagan's personal political stance against communism and liberalism is analogous to the fantasy and propaganda of Hollywood and rooted in his own inability to distinguish between movies and reality. Rogan claims that Reagan found himself in film, remembering and reliving his childhood through the roles he played on screen. However, it is more accurate to say that Rogan found Reagan in film using an imaginative biographical method that understood the president primarily as a symbol of American ideological fantasy and cast him in Rogan's own demonology as a figure only half real, an American monster created from the mythic fiction of Hollywood. Reagan's official biographer, Edmund Morris, also found movies at the heart of Reagan's inner myth, defining him as a performer who, he said, is not comprehensible unless he is witnessed, unless there's a spectator there. Morris wrote Dutch as a cinematic biography, bringing fiction and visual drama into his purportedly historical narrative. He also wrote it as a memoir, inserting himself as a fictional narrator who had observed Reagan for his entire life. His violations of the rules of historiography included a variety of other fictional characters, friends and relations of the fictional Morris, and several apparently tangential passages into their lives, complete with fabricated footnotes. For all its self-indulgence and the frustration it may cause, Dutch is not a failure of biography. Morris's innovation affirms the distance between the biographer and his subject, avoiding any pretense of certainty about Reagan's thoughts or motives, and allowing the reader to share the role of observer with discretion over the narrator's judgment. Moreover, Morris makes a sincere and convincing attempt to understand the nature of Reagan's significance to America, which is reflected and reinforced by his literary methods. In his prologue, the author relates a reflection which describes his and perhaps any presidential biographer's guiding purpose. Presidents, whatever their political symbolism, represent the national character of their era, and if we do not understand our leaders as people, we can never understand ourselves as Americans. Dutch represents an effort to find American national identity in the life of Ronald Reagan, but rather than describe its tenets, Morris explores its basis in the concepts of memory and narrative. Dutch is deliberately, emphatically subtitled A Memoir of Ronald Reagan. To relate Reagan's childhood and life, Morris uses the usual biographical tools of research, but also through acts of remembrance, both imagined and real. Early in the book, Morris recounts a trip he accompanied in 1992 to Tampico, Reagan's first visit to the town of his birth in over 70 years. As the chronicler of Reagan's life, Morris corrects the former president as he misremembers the details of his early life amidst the much-changed landscape of the town. He watches Reagan enter the room of his birth, seem to recoil and retreat from its blunt actuality. And in conversation afterwards, the author fails to keep the president's interest in his world of 80 years ago. Morris then essentially elects to act as Reagan's memory, or to try to rediscover it, a goal made more poignant by the president's decline into Alzheimer's disease as the book was written. Morris goes alone to Tampico, Dixon, and Chicago to walk in the places the young Reagan walked and reimagine his experiences through their landscapes and artifacts, appearing on occasion to even hallucinate whole episodes of Reagan's life. Later, he observes the young Reagan through the fictional memory of his narrator, recalling encounters in Dixon, Eureka, and Hollywood. This apparent lifelong fascination with Reagan is explained only at the end of the book, in what is perhaps the first twist to occur in biography and literary history. The narrator reveals to the reader that he was one of the 77 whose lives Reagan saved from the currents of the Rock River. Unable to thank Reagan in his last meeting with the president in 1994, he makes his gratitude a collective burden and a metaphor for Reagan's legacy. "Someday, I hoped, America might acknowledge her similar debt to the old lifeguard who rescued her in a time of poisonous despair." Morris records and invents these connections between the present and Reagan's youth to create a dramatic commemoration of his subject. Story and memory are for Morris the themes of Reagan's greatness, the means by which he understood and articulated his ideas, and by which he represented America. So they became the means by which Morris represented his life. Paul Kengel's God and Ronald Reagan, with its emphasis on the subject's faith and historical greatness, is not literal hagiography, the life writing of saints, but its themes and the direction of its narrative infuse Reagan's life with the concept of destiny. The book is shaped by the argument for Reagan's personal victory over the Soviet Union, and this emphasis informs the structure of the biography, creating a sense of historical purpose in the progress of Reagan's life. Reagan's life and political career, Kengel wrote, introducing his biography, coincided almost exactly with the rise and fall of communism in Russia. This observation directs the narrative, which opens with the young Reagan at Dixon's first Christian church on January the 20th, 1924, in a scene weighted with portent, though unrelated to any significant act or event in Reagan's life. The moment is important because, quote, "a continent away, 53-year-old Vladimir Ilyich Lenin lay near death in an even colder, in many ways, Bolshevik Russia. As Lenin clung to life, 12-year-old Dutch Reagan clung to his hymnal." This, Kengel elaborates, was the start of a spiritual pilgrimage that would lead the boy in the front pew to a spot in front of a bust of a grim Lenin at Moscow State University 64 years later. Kengel's later diversions into Soviet history relate to Reagan's political development and decisions. Here, however, his dramatic juxtaposition invests the child with destiny. Like Gary Wills, Kengel locates the young Reagan within American cultural and ideological tradition, but focuses on his religious inheritance. The author establishes the direct influences on Reagan's faith, notably his mother and the novel she encouraged him to read, That Printer of Udell's, which prompted him to become baptized at age 11. These influences provided grounds for an intellectual Christianity which defined for the young Reagan the roles of the individual and the church in society. But Kengel also frames Reagan's early faith in terms of the exceptionalist mission he would later apply to his anti-communism, and considers the broader, more indirect theological and historical influence of his church. The roots of Nellie Reagan's first Christian church were in the Disciples of Christ, founded early in the 19th century by the emigrant Scot Alexander Campbell, a proponent of a millenarian nationalist idea of a missionary American destiny. Kengel quotes Campbell's assertion that the world looked to America for, quote, "its emancipation from the most heartless spiritual despotism ever," and that, quote, "this is our special mission in the world as a nation and a people." Campbell, he stressed, saw America as a beacon, a light unto the nations, whose political institutions would provide inspiration for the overthrow of false religion and oppressive tyranny in Europe. In his conclusion that it was, quote, quite likely that he was introduced to these ideas by his pastor, Kengel finds the course and purpose of Reagan's life in his earliest years. This purpose is tied directly by the biographical narrative to American and Soviet history, and reinforced by the consistent theme of destiny, national and personal, that shaped Reagan's beliefs. The conventions of presidential biography have changed greatly over two centuries, but the mythic relevance of the presidency still holds its influence on the genre. One term coined to describe this influence is the Great Commoner Complex, whereby presidential biographers struggle to represent their subjects as ordinary human beings while still portraying them as America's definitive agents of history and representatives of their age and country. This issue is detectable in these biographies of Reagan. Wills and Morris approach Reagan as a flawed and complex character, compelling but often unremarkable, yet write his life as an exploration of national history and identity. Rogan sees Reagan as a confused and pathetic figure, but whose unlikely rise to the presidency describes America's own pathology. Paul Kengel explores the development of Reagan's personal faith, but understands it primarily as an influence and product of history. However, beyond the generic representation of the president-to-be as a symbol of national identity and history, these authors all put forward a representation of America unique to him as a symbol of American mythology, of the construction and communication of American identity. In Wills, he is a symbol of national fable, of American storytelling. For Rogan, he embodies national illusion and fantasy. Morris's Reagan embodies the ambiguity and vitality of America's self-imagination through memory and drama. In Kengel's work, Reagan is emblematic of the continuity, communication, and application of America's exceptionalist missionary ideology. In each case, this symbolism is most vivid in the representation of Reagan's childhood, where his young life is recounted, remembered, and revised as prologue to the 20th century. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Johnson, for that insightful presentation. And there will be Q&A that will come at the end of this session. Our second presenter today is Dr. Devin Bissonnette, who is currently teaching at Delta College in Michigan. He earned his PhD at Binghamton University in New York. And in addition to his work with history, he's very fascinated with sort of the intersection between media and history, and basically how Mr. Reagan was a product of the media age. In continuing with the theme of mythology, one of the things that he will be talking about in his paper is the marriage of the man and the myth in creating the political character of Mr. Reagan. So the second presentation today is Scripting an American Life, Autobiography, Ronald Reagan, and the Invention of a President.
Thank you. When I first started to think about what I wanted to cover, I really started to think about what does it mean Reagan in the Midwest? I've always had this certain vision, specifically as a media historian, about Reagan's image, how it comes about, of course, how Hollywood intersects in that. But at the same time, well, of course, one's coming of age is incredibly important in how their ideas are developed. But I've realized over time, I think historians tend to do this often with Reagan, is to think of him very much as a product. And while that can be valid depending on the framework you're looking at, I started to wonder if specifically thinking about Ronald Reagan as kind of the typification of the modern media president, is that to what extent can or should we think of Ronald Reagan as an actual agent of change as opposed to more of a passive spectator, as many might, but not so much for what he did or what he said, but for what he didn't say. And that's when I really started to think about how this issue of autobiography plays into the story of Ronald Reagan. And specifically, you know, as you just talked about the autobiographies and biographies about Reagan, how maddeningly difficult it can be at times to really feel you have a comfortable grasp on what Reagan was thinking at key moments in his life. And I started to think about that strategically, how that actually works into being kind of an ideal media candidate for the modern age. So first, what does this mean, kind of to be this modern media candidate? I'm sure we all have this idea in our head as to what that means. But I think there are a couple essential elements that we can kind of pull. First of which is the idea of that the ideal candidate is charismatic. Now, what does that mean? There are a lot of very fancy, boring definitions that we'll skip over. But to be charismatic means you, at the very least, have a very engaging personality. You can create an irrational connection with voters, and of course that there is a large pool of people that believe there's something extraordinary about you as an individual that makes you qualified, in this case of course, for the presidency. Now, the problem with charisma is that it is ultimately an irrational force, and that makes it a very, very bad thing if you're a political party. You don't want the pure charismatic candidate because they'll destroy the party, because everyone will have allegiance to the candidate and not to the party. So, in modern times, and this goes back to a broader study I've kind of done about the 20th century, is you see this kind of pure presidential type charismatic disappear, and parties begin to understand if you can control charisma, then it goes through the party, and then you ultimately strengthen the party identification as well. So, this type of charisma, pseudo-charisma, or manufactured charisma if you prefer, all it means is you find a candidate that can appear charismatic, that can draw the support of the charismatic, but is ultimately still controlled by the political party that they're a part of as a result. And obviously I'll talk about how that plays into Reagan later. The other key attribute is advertising. And that may sound fairly obvious in 2010 or 2011, as opposed to 1980, but when you're advertising, when you're trying to sell a product, you're trying to cultivate a certain emotional connection in an audience to say you need this product because, well, ultimately you lack this and this product will provide that. Whether you're talking about a presidential candidate or your Swiffer wet jet, the same basic idea plays in, is that you need to create that need, whether it's rational or irrational. And again, if you have a candidate that is capable of speaking in short, crisp phrases, exactly like a short advertisement's going to be. Again, you're building towards this mix of advertising and this mix of a specific type of candidate as well in the process. So, what about Reagan as this, in terms of his public image, that makes this type of imagery, this type of projection possible? Now, of course, we've already covered this in large part so far about some of his specific attributes, but the Midwestern kind of credibility, I guess, if probably the best way of putting it, that was certainly talked about in the morning sessions, I think is very important because you have this sort of connection. You can believe Ronald Reagan. He has that credibility because, we'll talk about a little bit more in a second, life wasn't easy for Reagan growing up. Certainly something that a lot of people can connect with in terms of Reagan's life. However, that being the case, Reagan also has this Hollywood story about him. People know Ronald Reagan not particularly for his life story, but for his Hollywood life story. And just as the public begins to mix the filmography of John Wayne with the actual military career of John Wayne, I think you see with Ronald Reagan, you mix the film roles with his actual roles too, because there isn't always a clear definition, because you have this Midwestern rhetoric, but you also have this Western image, which in part certainly relates back to his filmography as well. So you have that familiarity with the candidate, which is very important in kind of building brand recognition over time that Reagan's able to do. And finally, and specifically for Reagan, is he's able to surround himself with people that understand that media is evolving. The media is becoming more visual, that television is starting to take over, and that requires a different type of candidate that you're going, as opposed to the ideal candidate for the age of newspaper reporters, and the ability to have a rapport with a small group, but that small group then types up a story and presents it, whereas the candidate is now out in front more than ever. And again, Reagan's ability, going back to his days in radio, to be able to reproduce those stories is going to be critical in that. Now, Reagan's, of course, early years are being documented quite a bit here. As I said before, very first, economic troubles. We've talked about some of the family difficulties as well. This already, again, creates a certain similarity with the audience, but autobiographically, it's not something Reagan likes to dwell on. He leaves a lot of absences that I believe are critical because it gives the chance of the individual to fill that with their own understanding, with their own experiences. The less you know, the more you're able to say those snippets you do know, you can identify with. And again, that strengthens the identification between voter and candidate, which I think is, again, critical in the case of Ronald Reagan. As Reagan moves towards high school, towards graduation, we've already heard several times about how everything good in Reagan's life really started at Eureka, which of course implicitly indicates that what happened before Eureka isn't really something that he felt was a positive experience in the least. But what Reagan did learn, I believe, at that point is that putting himself out in the public, the introverted childhood that he had because he was moving around so much, that it fueled his ego and it fueled his popularity. Yet Reagan privately remained as remote as possible. He was learning how to create a specific public image and a very likable public image. Not an ideological image, just a familiar and friendly public image. Now, of course, at Eureka, the quote that his principal ambition was to maintain the C average he needed so that he could participate in all the extracurricular activities that he wanted to is one of those good examples of, again, not only does he like to speak in anecdote only about these periods, but that he eschews all this a focus on intellectualism. And that sort of ability to be anti-intellectual on the surface is, I believe, another essential element in understanding this myth, this image that is created about Reagan, because you simply didn't know what his focus was. I mean, it's more of his academic papers and things may be studied. That will certainly give a window into it. But in general, by not presenting that and not talking about it, it still shrouds in mystery. What was Reagan thinking about? What issues were important? Was he thinking about philosophy? Was he thinking about government? How was he thinking about that? Again, voters who are more central ideas rather than these deep philosophical treatises on these subjects, again, can find identification with Reagan in that, getting to the essential point from the start. Now, certainly once Reagan moves on to radio, he learns at the critical role of the ability to sound spontaneous even when you're not. Imagine it's, again, fairly obvious now just how important that can be as a presidential candidate to be able to answer a question off the cuff without making it sound like you've been rehearsing it for days, because, of course, you can generally expect the type of question that you're going to be. And that sort of early education, even though this was for a career in Hollywood, not for a political career, is another way in which Reagan can help create that connection with the public, again, first through Hollywood and later through other methods. In Hollywood, of course, as the acting career nominally takes off, Reagan begins to develop a certain public image. He's not, of course, a tremendous success in Hollywood, but there's name recognition, or again, if you think of the language of advertising, brand recognition. Meanwhile, behind the scenes, with his work with the Screen Actors Guild, Reagan's honing his persuasive skills as well, both publicly and privately, creating a certain kind of surface ideological image. But again, even in Hollywood, his friends are saying they still don't really know, ideologically speaking, what makes Reagan tick. Now, his marriage to Jane Wyman and the divorce, another example of how Reagan takes explicit autobiographical control, because he just doesn't talk about it. He's hesitant to even engage about it even happening. And another instance where, of course, the public can identify with the idea of divorce, but at the same time, by refusing to give details about it, between, of course, what biographers will fill into the blank or fill into the blanks about it, again creates a situation where an individual who has gone through any of these experiences can therefore kind of fill that in, and you create that mythic connection between Reagan, his life, his experiences, and those individual experiences along the way. So by the 1950s, when Reagan transitions into television, General Electric Theater, his career is obviously taking a new trajectory through a new medium, but it is giving Reagan very early experience in just how television works, the kind of experience that Richard Nixon could have really used in 1960, where he found out it's really important to understand how mediums work, because if you don't look good in one medium, it can have significant effects on how people perceive you. But as was mentioned before, as Reagan goes about the country on these GE tours, he becomes more ideological, but again, both as a speaker and as a public figure through television, Reagan's visibility is now growing. I mean, literally into the American living room every week. And as Reagan said about it once, many people develop an affection and feelings of friendship for someone they enjoy on the screen, and that could be an advantage for me. It's about as much as Reagan would kind of explicitly indicate that this connection does matter. Now, as Reagan transitions into the 60s, GE finally lets him go because he's becoming more ideological in his speeches and begins to concern GE to some extent. Reagan's kind of conservative political speaking career really begins to take off. And the time for choosing speech in 1964, I believe, is really that key moment that identifies Reagan as kind of the ideal conservative candidate of the age. The Barry Goldwater campaign is not going well. Doesn't appear he has a chance of winning the election. But when he's asked to give this basic plea for the Goldwater campaign to get money, he, of course, agrees to do it. And as a result, despite the dismal hopes for the campaign, the Goldwater team gets an $8 million as a result of this fundraising pledge. Again, a tremendous amount for a campaign that at this point, this was shortly before the election, appeared almost completely doomed. But what it shows showed the conservatives within the Republican Party that Reagan could do what Goldwater couldn't. He could make conservative policies seem moderate. And by that, he could actually extend the olive branch between the moderates and the conservatives in the Republican Party that by 1964 had torn the party apart. Though Richard Nixon would, in the short term, attempt to mend those fences to relatively mixed results. So now that it appeared that Reagan kind of could be the standard bearer for this modern type of conservatism, the question is, where does he run? What does he do? And again, this has also been brought up earlier, the governorship of California becomes the targeted point. What is found very quickly as Reagan's candidacy shapes up is that he has, it's very able behind the scenes and then publicly to craft this unifying voice. He is able to placate conservatives, that he has conservative values and he will carry those out, but he is able to placate the moderates in the Republican Party, and of course moderates outside of the Republican Party too, that he is still attempting to be a unifying force. Now, also important in this is what's specifically going on in California in the mid to late 60s, as among student unrest, the Black Panthers, a number of, at the very least, perceived to be divisive and sometimes violent elements in California society. And Reagan has the kind of Midwestern credibility, if you want to put it that way, to rebuke, to be parental, to be firm, but at the same time still not to look completely callous about the situation. Now, of course, the students at Berkeley wouldn't have felt that way, but it's clear a lot of the voters of California indeed felt that this was the rhetoric that they needed at that point, that that kids should be quiet and go to school and enjoy their classes and leave the governing to the generation of their parents. So, of course, Reagan wins election in 1966, but is he this ideal media candidate? No, not even close. One of the greatest criticisms in that 1966 run is that when he answered policy questions, he sounded a bit like a tape recorder, which of course is one of the worst things. If you're not If you're not sounding spontaneous, if you're sounding contrived, you are not drawing in your audience. So with two terms in California, and then, of course, a couple or several years in between before he eventually successfully runs in 1980, there's a chance to hone these skills. Not perfectly, as I'll talk about in a minute, but an ability to get a greater grasp of these connections between media and between the public. How do you draw the public in? How do you now kind of understand some of these broader issues going on in American society? Because what Reagan and his team certainly discover is that on issues, Reagan is very blunt and very kind of, say, simplistic on the surface as to what he believes, which creates, in this period, the ideal rebranding of Ronald Reagan as the citizen politician. You take a lack of experience, and now that becomes a strength. That what makes Reagan great is his ability to be a normal voter, ultimately, in the end. He's a citizen, he cares, that's why he's running, that's what makes him both unique, average, and extraordinary at the same time, because he just happens to be in this position. So, by 1980, there are a number of somewhat unique conditions that kind of coalesce around Ronald Reagan. Media itself is changing. As television takes over as the dominant source of news, or has taken over as the dominant source of news for the public, you have a different style of politician that's necessary. You're going to be rebroadcasting bits of speeches. You're certainly not rebroadcasting whole speeches. Newspapers are responding in kind. They're not going to reprint whole speeches. They're going to start giving more snippet views as well. You need a candidate who's going to be able to give these short, crisp phrases, someone with a pleasant demeanor and a pleasant visual to put on television. This is still advertising driven on television as well. You want to have content that people want to see. And again, Reagan's ability to put not only his anecdotes out there that certainly drew attention, but his ability to sum up often very complex political arguments in relatively simple terms makes him that much more appealing, especially as opposed to some of the people he would have faced both in the primaries and then as he ran for office. So through the campaigns, as I've started to look at specific newspaper representations at this point in 1980, there is some example that there is some spontaneity, there is some irrationality as to how Reagan is being viewed by the voting public. However, this appears very much limited to the Republican faithful, and still a segment of the Republican faithful at that, that Reagan has achieved this kind of true charismatic bond with the public. It's very clear that Reagan is still, his popularity is ultimately still very conditional by 1980. Though, of course, he obviously wins election in 1980, that he seems in some ways extraordinary, but at the same time, a remarkably human candidate. One of my favorite examples that I read is when he was in San Diego at a campaign stop, there was a heckler there making fun of him, and he just turned and said, "Oh, shut up." And they got a huge cheers from the crowd, because what I would say is that's what they would have done, or what they would have at least wanted to do. And again, that ability to be both extraordinary and to be like everybody else at the same time, that model, I believe, again, it doesn't end in 1980, and that's one of the things I really started to find as I really started to reevaluate Reagan, is that this story of both charisma and creating the modern presidential candidate doesn't end just because he wins election. It's clear that that support is still conditional. Now, of course, we can go through Reagan's accomplishments in his 8 years in office, the end of the Cold War, his ability to take his cowboy image and literally project that through his own actions. Again, that Midwestern credibility, but that Western visual that proved very appealing as well. That by the time Reagan leaves office, or at least within the couple of years after he's out of office, there are a number of accomplishments that he can attach to his record as kind of the ultimate Cold Warrior, in some ways perhaps the final Cold Warrior. So how does that kind of lead up to this post-Reagan America, this post-Reagan candidate? Well, this ability to manage charisma, this ability for political parties to kind of create this image didn't, as I first thought, kind of matter so much whether you win election, but how you're remembered thereafter. And certainly now that Reagan's been out of office for decades, or a couple decades now, it gives a chance to really see that there's a fascinating disconnect between what you're going to read in academic circles about Reagan and a lot of conflicts about Reagan, but a reminder that, in this, especially in this question of myth, what's going on in academia doesn't particularly represent what the actual public, the, of course, the voter, is actually thinking. And you find in 2003, 20% of Americans said Ronald Reagan was the greatest, excuse me, in 2005, 20% of people said Ronald Reagan was the greatest president of all time. A recent Gallup poll from the past couple of years, Reagan has the second highest approval rating of any president from the past 50 years. The only president with a higher approval rating happens to be John F. Kennedy, who, of course, didn't complete a term in office. But as the assassination certainly plays a role in the image people have of JFK, I think what you're starting to see is, by Reagan's absence of autobiography, his absence of this clear story, it creates these perfect gaps that we can all find ourselves in, that we can all say there's a little bit of myself and Ronald Reagan, a little bit of Ronald Reagan in me, that has shown candidates thereafter is this is how you model yourself after the public. You find a way to make yourself the everyman, slowly but surely the everywoman as well, that it you just need to find some sort of specific connection that you can project through media, because you do not have direct connections with the public, you have them through media. And by this ability to mediate these representations, that you are essentially able to create the image you prefer. And if a party can control that, and even symbolically, of course, as we see certainly the symbols of Reagan around here, that symbolic authority is particularly useful for the party in moving forward. But as we see with Reagan in particular, it's incredibly important in understanding how perception of a candidate, perception of an individual, essentially, from a historical point of view, becomes reality, because it is clear the gap between academic memory and public memory on Ronald Reagan, I think, really shows that, well, I don't think Reagan's target was ever, you know, legacy. His ability, his target was the public. And looking in at 2011, where Reagan's memory is, I think that myth has been quite successful, that there is still an ultimate and easy attachment to make between Reagan the image and everyone else, that I think will continue to make Reagan's legacy and the perception of the public towards Reagan will continue to increase continually as we academics continue to struggle over what Ronald Reagan's memory actually happens to be. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Bissonnette, for that excellent presentation. We have, I believe, about 7 minutes for our Q&A. So we have individuals with microphones. If you have a question, please.
Okay. In view of the political polarity in today's world, and considering that Ronald Reagan is the conservative American icon, do you perceive a concerted effort in a left-leaning academic world to diminish his accomplishments and diminish him as a symbol?
There are certainly a few books out there that are, there's one, I forget the name of the author, but it was about Reagan and Main Street, and he sought to demonstrate that Reagan's policies had destroyed the American small town. And he went to Dixon and tried to argue that Dixon's decline was Reagan's fault, and to create, to break that link between Reagan and his roots, essentially. There's others who, less trying to destroy Reagan as an icon, I think they're trying to appropriate him as a moderate and as a pragmatist, and seek to undermine conservative mythology. There's conservative mythology of Reagan is the most common sort of buzzword at the moment. I think Will Bunch wrote a book, and there's various other sort of responses to that. And the efforts are to show that Reagan was anti-nuclear, pro-amnesty. There's various several issues, pro-environment, and seek to turn him into more of a national icon and remove his partisan, the partisan connection to him. I think that's what's happening.
Yeah, to build on that, I think that, Reagan exists now as this complete symbol, and while academics, there's certainly a back and forth as to how to assess Reagan's memory, I really think if you want to look at what Reagan means, watch the news channels, you know, see what's going on in print, even what field journalists are saying about Ronald Reagan, when is he invoked? I think that's the real struggle today over memory, because there are so many news sources out there now, so many places that people may get their information from, is that it's much harder, I think, for just a relative few to control meaning and control memory. And, of course, you know, even just to Google Ronald Reagan, what comes up, what sorts of ideologies are at play, how recent are those? I know President Obama invoked Reagan at least once during the campaign, which caused a bit of a stir, but it's clear that, as you said, that there may be a way to invoke Reagan outside of that conservative ideology as well, and I don't think we're even close to seeing the end of that story yet, because I think, in part, Reagan left us so many gaps that we can always debate that, and he'll always, to some extent, exist in memory instead of history because of that.
Okay, we have another question over here.
It was mentioned that Reagan, in his life, as opposed to like delving into his childhood, had a few well-rehearsed anecdotes, and that now people see Reagan as this kind of your face here president. And I wondered if that kind of lack of depth or willingness to go into his life, if that was like a purposeful effort on his part so that he would be this kind of everyman for all of the people, or if that just came about by his general lack of willingness.
Well, I think that's kind of the beauty of Reagan, is because he wasn't forthcoming about that. You just don't know for sure. Was it a strategy? Was it just he was reserved by nature? In some ways, it may be best to think about what happened as these are the events that happened and these are the products, that we may get so bogged down in discussing, was Reagan doing this as an intentional strategy? Or does it simply show that this model is an effective way of shaping yourself as a presidential candidate? I'm not sure we can ever know. And again, I think that's part of the reason why Reagan's memory will continue to be debated, because it's so hard to close the door on that.
We have time for one more question.
I was just wondering what you guys think the image and myth, I guess you could say, of Reagan. People of my generation, what we think of when we think of President Reagan, and people who worked with him or grew up with him as president, or people who, you know, experienced him while he was alive, I guess.
Well, I suppose the difference between, the obvious difference is that with Reagan's common generation, they shared the same experiences of history. I suppose the sort of the most recent generation who have born after his presidency, their first point of call is are the debates about Reagan that are going on now, and the efforts to the competition over his legacy and his memory. So I guess you can pick and choose to a certain extent. Sort of which Reagan you want to remember, and in a way that his own generation I've lost the train of thought there. Do you want to...
When I teach Reagan, well, one thing I find is that history books, textbooks themselves, are often very conflicted about Reagan. Sometimes they may truncate Reagan's record because in some cases it seems it's hard to talk about. In a number of cases, it's a generation that's writing history books right now that experience, you know, very viscerally what life under Reagan was like, which I think a lot of writers almost try so hard to compensate for that. It completely convolutes the record. But what I like to do in terms of teaching history, especially modern history, is show as many visual examples as possible. And what I found is Reagan, in many ways, is in just brilliant YouTube-era candidate, because if you take those speeches, you take his best moments from those speeches, from those campaign stops, those who were at the dinner last night, some of those snippets, they play so well now, is that I would guess, as kind of visual media becomes more and more powerful as a storyteller, that ultimately Reagan's image to future generations will look better and better, because that's what will be remembered of Reagan, is his ability to look so in control, to look so persuasive, to appear such an effective head of state no matter what was going on, is that that's the kind of visual record he leaves behind, and I think that's ultimately what will communicate to future generations.
Please join me in congratulating Professors Johnson and Bissonnette for an outstanding panel. I think there's time for a brief break
right
now, so maybe...
Yep, very short break. We're just going to change over the set.